budget workshop only, not a regular board meeting. We do have one agenda item we need to address in a timely manner. We will then adjourn and then end the workshop. There will be no public in. If we could stand for the pledge, please.
I'm new to this, and so I'm just trying to understand the probationary status of administrators. I understand when it comes to teachers, it really has to do with tenure, is that correct? But when it comes to administrator, what's the impact of this vote? Please know that any administrator in the building, I certainly support. There's no reason, I'm just asking about the status and the purpose of it. I understand the purpose when it comes to teachers, because it changes their employment contract, essentially, when it comes to being a tenured employee. I'm not aware of the difference when it comes to administration.
Similarly, it does impact their contract, as we discussed when we were going through their contract. And so they're moving from a single-year contract to a multiple-year contract.
Does that affect their evaluation process?
Does it what?
Does that affect their evaluation process?
So as we discussed again when we were talking about the updating the contract,
yep.
We talked about the fact that at any point in time for any administrator, if there are performance issues or concerns, that doesn't bind us to anything. We can move ahead with the process.
So I guess, so if that is always the case, I'm struggling with understanding the difference between the two levels. And if you can't talk about that because it's specific to the contract, then I will acquiesce and just understand, and that I have more to learn. And if that's the case, then just say that's the case.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay.
Motion made and seconded. All in favor of accepting the to the continuing contract?
And I'm simply just going to abstain until I learn more about it. It has nothing to do with being negative to it whatsoever.
And we would need a motion for the
moving from one to two.
I'll second. So the last thing on our agenda is the adjournment of a regular meeting. Second.
Yes,
the adjournment. workshop. I want to stress that we are down to our last session before the board can vote on a final budget on April 4th. We need to be mindful that we have some decisions to make tonight. I would like to review our board norms before we begin to guide us in the right direction.
Those norms are on your agenda for this evening.
We will deal respectfully with each other. We will stand for our decisions. Our work together will be time-bound, focused, and valuable. We will work to continuously model professional collaboration. We will rely on and trust each other. Communication will be timely, taken with positive intentionality and focused. We will demonstrate value for each other. We will be fully engaged in meetings. Thank you.
So this document is going to look familiar. This is what we've been working on for the last couple of weeks. The process that we're going to go through this evening, as Elva mentioned, next week is coming fast, and there's a lot of prep work that Denise needs to go through between now and next Thursday, so this really needs to be a focused meeting. We're going to review the items that we have unanimously agreed upon. Then we're going to stop at that point, and we're going to have an overview of some of the implications and talk about percent that we want to bring forward to the towns based on the information that Denise will present, and then we will go through the list of the administration recommended reductions that were not unanimous last week. There were some that we wanted to revisit, and then the items that were presented by individual board members for further discussion, and that's on the back, the reverse of that sheet. And those items, we handed that information out late last Thursday night. So we have not really discussed those items. So as we get to that point, if there are questions, we can go through those. So we will look again at the beginning part of this section, agreed upon increases and decreases. So as we look through all of these, and I don't need to read those through, we've gone through them. That puts us with all of those unanimous items, and some of that came up last week, some of it was prior to last week. That puts us at 9.5% to taxpayers at that point in time. I'm going to have Denise now spend some time talking a little bit about, we're going to do this one first. Okay. Both of them? Okay. We're handing both out at the same time, but we really want you paying attention to this first one. This is my disclaimer. So this is the first one we will discuss, and I will hand out the second one. Okay. So I wanted to walk you through the district formula for local share. So this is the information that basically boils down to how much is going to be assessed both per town. And I was asked to get estimates for what that means for taxpayers on a $100,000 assessment. So the top section is, the top section determines what percentage each town will be responsible for once we determine a budget. So this state valuation comes directly from the ED 279, which you have in your binder, but I think it's on page 5, but those valuations are in there, and you take a percentage, so we prorate each town, and each town gets a percentage of the total district valuation. We then take pupils, similarly, we take an average of two prior years to get an average pupil. Again, we get a percentage by town, and then the average percentage is just a straight average. So you can see in this, again, in this draft, again, I want to say this is draft, you can see that Berwick is looking like it will be up 0.01%, 11.14%, and North Berwick will be going down 0.15%. So again, that's how we get the percentages. When you go down to the next section, we're looking at fiscal year costs, which is the school each town has an average, which is taken from above. You then have the local revenue. This is the amount that, it's the amount we'll collect from all revenue sources, taken from the expenses, and whatever remains the towns have to pay. You'll see what it was for 24 and 25 and what the increase is in dollars. And that's the way it goes for all three sections. You'll notice that while there is no increase to local revenue for adult education, because the percentages changed, you'll notice that each town has an increase or a decrease. Very small, $9 in 1 year. And school nutrition was zero, is proposed zero, so there is no change. So then what I do is I take the valuation of the town and divide it into the total cost that each town has to pay, divided by 1,000. And that gives the estimate per taxpayer by town for every $100,000 of assessed value.
The valuation that the towns have versus the
what percentage is the municipality, what percentage is the school, they break it down. I don't know if it's correct.
I don't doubt that it's correct, but it may not mirror this. That's all.
Just give me one idea.
Okay, a couple of meetings ago, there was a discussion about the comfort level as far as knowing community, knowing what we're faced against as far as positions, cuts, increases. And so it seemed like at that point in time, there was a level of working comfort with a 5 to 6. So I just want to revisit that. And before we move ahead, I know that there were some, I know that wasn't unanimous, and we weren't looking for that unanimous piece at that point. We just wanted a starting point. And again, we want a starting point for this evening so that we can move ahead. So any comments? Additions? Yes.
I thought that we voted school resource officer down, so I'm not sure why it's down there on that list on the bottom.
So, which is not
It was unanimous.
We're not going to do it unless it's unanimous?
No, we're just, right now we're just trying to get the percent. Okay. We just want a target percent, and then we'll talk about that administrative recommendations again.
I really don't feel comfortable going forward with anything higher than 6%.
I think 6 is reasonable.
I think 6 is going to be really hard to get to, though.
Yeah, I mean, how much less is that in the budget? The public that's over here being more comfortable more than 6. But I know a lot of people aren't.
I think with the amount of foreclosures that are going on, I think 5 is really pushing it.
I mean, the other thing too that's tough is like we also just have to be very frank, because we are coming out of a lot of COVID grants, and so that's going to be an impact. It's something we just have to be, you know, as long as we're making good decisions.
I know at least in North Berwick, there's a large population of senior citizens, of which I'm one. So I want to respect that they are on fixed incomes and still contributing to our schools, even though they may not have children in our schools.
We know we are no farther on any knowledge about energy costs.
So what I will tell you is this. We were looking at an energy broker, and we have been trying to vet that energy broker both by talking to references and business managers and districts that have used this people, and talking again to Maine Power Options, which is the state agency that has helped us traditionally. And we may be able to see some savings. It would be half a year on supply only. So it could be as much, it could be, I haven't been able to pull the numbers, like crunch the kilowatt hours we use and all of that. I did very ballpark estimate, maybe 50,000, maybe a little more, but it's not going to be too much more than that. But it is something that I'm continuing to look at, and if I can get more in there, I will certainly do that. By next Thursday.
So let's talk health insurance. Let me find that one. We did hear back from the Benefits Trust, and their email I will summarize. Basically, they voted for the range that would be no lower than 1.5%. And in previous history, it's always been 0 was the lowest. And the maximum would be 11.5%, which is significantly more than historical. They said the community rate is 6.5, that's a special group of Anthem users. We are currently budgeted at 7%. And
given that we are less than that one, so one is the break-even point where what we paid in premiums, they paid out the claims, that's one. We were to the good side of that, 0.91 and change, but I honestly don't feel comfortable going much lower than 7, just because that range is so big. If that range had stopped at 7, 8, 9, I might be tempted, but and we won't know until April 10th, which is after we have to decide. This group that does this only does this for school districts in Maine, so it's beyond me why this can't be done a month earlier, so that we have the information to make the budget. I say I send it every year.
So if they do come in at a lower number, will that impact this budget?
Usually no.
No, so what will we do with the
what's overages? So anything that's overage, like with anything we budget, it goes to the fund balance, which then goes to the next budget cycle and we move forward. So every any savings we get during the year. So again, we may have savings on medical, but if a boiler at the Hussey School goes and we have to pay for that, sometimes that's how it gets used. But if any monies that are unused always go to fund balance, and then we try to allocate them to a future budget cycle. Because it's taxpayer funds. We're keeping it and using it for taxpayers.
Yep, just wanted to make sure that's clear.
Yep.
During this week, I was doing a lot of research. The graph that was given us last week, remember the line graph that we were given in comparison to other districts? And it didn't include debt service and it didn't include transportation. And it just got me thinking, like, wait a minute, is this stuff available? It turns out it is available. It's on the, I don't know what that, like ESSA, it's the Department of Education Maine dashboard, is what it's called. And so what I did is I spent a number of hours, and I looked up every school district in York County. I didn't exclude any. I looked up every school district in York County. I pulled out all the categories, instruction, special ed, transportation, debt service, operations and maintenance. I mean, just all the categories that are in our budgets that we look at. And I did it for every school district in York County for the 22-23 school budget, which was the most recent data they had, right? So then, under each category, I ranked it, like I sorted it, right? So, well, I color-coded every single number, right? So, you know, Noble was maroon, you know, Sanford was red, right? Kittery was gold, so it was all that. And so, I needed to get an overview. That's what I needed to get, right? And the reason I'm telling you this whole story is because, like, what I found wasn't what I expected. So what I found, and I passed this on, and I just passed this on this afternoon to poor Audra and Sue, and I said, would you take a look at this? And they respectfully said, we have a board meeting tonight, and you know, we're not going to look at this today. Understand, right? Totally understand. And after now saying this, I'll share it with the rest of you, but please understand, that it's what I pulled. If there are mistakes in there, they're my mistakes. I apologize for it. But it gave a really good overview, and the basic overview is this, is that financially, per student, if you look at per student expenditures across all of York County, MSAD60 is in the bottom third. Okay? And I've been very public not liking our academic achievement results. I've been very clear about that, right? But our achievement results are mid, like literally middle of the pack of York County. So, you know, really proud of the staff and just everybody, they're really working very hard. So where I was a few weeks ago and saying, you know, hey, I want to be at 3%. Yeah, I don't like how expensive education is. And I think education is trying to do a whole lot, which is why teachers are frazzled. And I'm one of them, right? But I got to recognize where we're at. And so where I would have said 3% a few weeks ago, I've moved. And I've moved because the reality is that it's cost a lot. I think we need to have honest conversations about what our priorities are as a school system, what we're actually going to pay for, what we actually want to measure, what we actually want to move, and just start getting real focused. I do want to have that conversation, but that same conversation can't come at that point of squeezing blood out of a rock. So I don't know what number I'm comfortable with. Honestly, I don't know what number I'm comfortable with. I still have things I'd like to discuss, and I'm discussing tonight. So I'm not set at a number, but I want to be clear about that. I'm still not at 3, which was the last time I spoke. And it's really because I did some significant digging. And yeah, I have some conclusions, and that affected me. So, thank you.
Okay, so we'll continue, or does anyone else want to weigh in?
I guess I'm down there.
Is there a agreement with Joe? I'm not stuck on a number. I'm stuck at a point where I think if we cut too deep, we're causing problems. I get it. I know people, elderly, but I get it. But I mean, we still have to do the best we can to educate the district, and we are. We don't want to go down that road.
All right, so the next section that we're looking at is the administration recommended reductions. These items were not unanimous, and some of them were coming up back up to discuss anyway, so we are going to look at all this again briefly because we've had conversations about them, but I know that there was some material or just thinking that we needed to have happen during between last week and this week. So we will just start at the beginning. So again, as you can see, remove one world language teacher at a high school, the cost is there, the vote was 4-5 last time. So that's so just how you read that part.
Yeah, right. So if that 57-8, what impact does that have dollar wise? I think that's okay. Or percent? 6.63. I am concerned about that. Oh, wait, no, I think you misunderstood my question.
Oh, okay. She's looking at the 6.63.
Yeah.
I'm looking at the 6.63.
Oh, so you want to assume the 6.63.
Right.
So I'm glad we're talking about this again. I love teachers, and I know they make a huge difference. It's one of those things where administration thought critically about their staff. They recommended this. AJ stood here and said that there would be zero impact to the offerings. They would not change any of the offerings in our high school. And all the opportunities would still exist. He did acknowledge that numbers in classrooms in some levels may go up a little bit, but it was his professional opinion that that would be acceptable. And so, I mean, that's why I voted for it. Right? We have administration to do that job specifically, and it's not easy. He was very uncomfortable saying it quite clearly, right? Lots of staff.
That right? That wasn't necessarily my understanding.
If I misunderstood, I'd love to be clarified on that.
But yeah, are we definitely not losing any? Are we maintaining all languages that we offer at all levels that we're currently offering, and also the level of lesson planning, I guess, too, is something I thought about after because all the courses are so different than lesson planning.
Yeah, so I mean, I think we would do everything we can to keep all languages. But what else, and I will just say, so we offer right now French, Spanish. 6 sections, essentially, of each of those. We also offer Russian and Latin. those two languages, we only have one teacher each dedicated to two blocks. So again, so like the ones and twos are together, the threes and fours. What might have to happen is one of those less popular, doesn't sound like quite the right word, but less sectioned languages could potentially go down to one section. There would be some possibility, and again, we're gonna minimize the impact. So we're looking at numbers. If we can make Spanish 3 bigger to save Russian 3 and 4, obviously we're gonna do that. So there would be no language that would disappear. It would get trickier. I mean, that's the nature of it. But we would do everything we can to preserve our offerings. Again, as you guys know, our numbers in Latin are not huge. There may be a total of 30 students. So again, going from two sections to one, it gets difficult. But again, I completely recognize we're at that difficult stage. So yes, nothing would go away. We would try to consolidate, try to see what we can do for numbers. So our goal would not be, it's not as simple from my perspective as we're gonna cut Latin disappears, okay, we're good to go. We wouldn't want to do that.
But in the same levels, so the opportunity to reach the same levels?
Yeah, I mean, again, we would hope they would reach the same level, but it might be within the same block. You might have a teacher kind of having the four corners of their room, having some different materials, maybe the fours working with the ones. Again, I think we will do everything we can to keep as much. I mean, that's what everyone I understand has spoken to you and said they'll do. And we absolutely will.
To help. So this will necessitate laying off one teacher?
It would. We currently have a world language staff of 7 teachers that would potentially go from 7 to 6. Yeah. Yes, everything is filled currently. I know that's sometimes a question that, is there an opening, is this an ad? We have had 7 for the last few years, and it would be 7 to 6. Yeah. Help?
And Peg, to your point of world languages, I agree. I would love to see world languages start in elementary schools as one of the expressive arts. I would replace one of the expressive arts with world languages and make that adjustment for that reason. I agree with you that we would benefit so much as a community, as a society, to be bilingual. But that's not solely serviced just by our high school. That would be a pretty significant adjustment for some districts. And again, not a conversation for tonight, but to your point, I agree with you.
Make sure there's, and maybe reverb.
There's just no reason.
Can I make a request for the for those watching on video? We can't see all the cards from the recording position, so if you could say, you know, the number in favor and opposed, it would clarify it for viewers.
So I will go back to, even though I said it, I'll say it again.
Thank you.
The vote for to remove one world language teacher at Noble High School was 6 to remove, 2 not to remove.
It's a straw poll.
So we will do the straw poll for this one as well, just for the audience and everybody who will be watching this recording, to remove the school resource officer from Lebanon. That was a proposal. It's not a current position. It's not anybody that currently holds that position. And that remains 7. In favor of removing that position, 2 against.
No, serious.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I'm glad you took it.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, the next one is to remove Noble Flex. We did discuss this last week. Do you want to share some further information?
I don't have a lot of further information. I'm just going to share that although this is a very, in my opinion, it's an important program, it is also one that I feel strongly that we financially cannot sustain in light of what's happening in the district. And we will work really hard to find other avenues to support this program, but I don't feel in good conscience that we can put this forward when we have all these other things that we are dealing with. And it's unfortunate, and I feel bad for saying it, but that is really, truly how I'm feeling in terms of what we need to do for our district in terms of our finances. So I'm resubmitting this to you, and I know it's hard. So if you have questions for me, I'm happy to answer whatever I can. Go ahead.
What happens? So those kids get put back into the mainstream?
Okay. So currently, so there's one of the clarifying things I think we can put out there is AJ does have a program that's running 9 and 12. So we have currently 6 eighth graders who are going to move into that program. There are only 3 students, I believe, in my project, I think it was 3 students who are currently planning to sign on for the next, for the current kids continuing on. There are 2 or 3 students who are thinking about, or definitely going to go back into the regular programming, giving that a try, and there's a couple of students who are going to homeschool. So those 3 students each have an individual plan that we're going to have to work with them. The other piece is they're actively asking, like looking for new enrollees. So there are some students who are currently interested. And again, we will work to try to support those students as best we can. I don't have a good answer for finding funding outside right now, but I'm going to, we're scouring it, trying to get the supports we can. It is one of those very positive experiences that we would love to be able to continue, but I need to be thoughtful of the budget.
So do you know, get any idea what the, if this were to stay in the budget, what the anticipated enrollment would be next year?
So right now I think it would be, well, solidly 8 have enrolled, or this is an application process, so 8 have applied. And they're working, it's only March, so they're working hard to increase the enrollment. In terms of the numbers, I would imagine we could probably double that to like 16, which is a plus. And we are also, we are recruiting in looking at, particularly for the middle school population, so bringing students back to where they can talk to them. But again, there's no guarantees of that, and I hesitate to hang my hat on that.
What is your level of confidence of finding grants and things to keep it? And the second question is, can the program be trimmed down? Like, can that number be trimmed down at all?
We've talked about reducing staff, and basically currently there's 2 teachers and there's a social worker who actually oversees the whole program. And we've talked about reducing to one teacher with just sort of a supervisory sort of stipend for the social worker. It can be trimmed, but I think it would dilute the program so significantly that I'm not sure the impact would be as positive. You're talking about grades 5 through 8, a teacher having to teach, it's one schoolhouse type of thing, but it spans quite a bit of certification and subject areas. So I would suggest that might be so much of a reduction that it wouldn't be the best fit. Does that completely eliminate the thought process of becoming creative? No. Because maybe it's 3 or 4 kids, and we talk about that as an integration with our regular programming. You know, so we've been really talking about all kinds of ideas to support these students as best they can. In terms of the funding part of it, Lauren, I can't guarantee anything. If we've been looking already, so it's not like my hope would have been that I could have been able to say, we're going to take this off of the district plate, and it's going to be over here, and this wouldn't even be a conversation. But it's not something that I have solid in front of me.
One of the things that I've been struggling with on this, if it's 8 students, it's essentially $30,000+ per student to run that program.
Right.
In our current future cycle per pupil expenditures, if the numbers are anywhere close, with grants, we're around $17,000 per student. I sit here and I struggle with the fact, and I significantly struggle with this. We had a long middle school staffing decision that we made, and that's nearly equivalent. That's $233,000 when we had the discussion about reducing a team at the middle school. You know, from what I hear from community members and all that, our middle school is in need of some serious help and support. And given the choice between those two options, I would rather see those teachers come back to the middle school in a place that truly needs a lot of support than flex. I mean, I would make that one. I trade it right now to do that. You know, and I think we need to think seriously about that discussion back to middle school. I know this is the last night, but it's been on my mind significantly. And with all the, maybe you guys hear differently, but I walked on the middle school. I visited it. I've heard from several staff members. I've heard from several community members. There's real concerns there, and reducing about staff that has been proposed. I don't, at this point sitting here right now, I do not think that that's the best idea.
So Sue, if we were to look at a per pupil cost, what would the break even number be for enrollments, 19 or 20?
Where's your math skill for me?
Yeah, I would say 19 or 20. Like, that's sort of the goal that we have, like between an 18 and 20.
But you're at 8 right now, and you think maybe 16?
It's up in the air, to be honest with you. I would love to be able to, give you hard answers, but I can't. That's what the enrollment application process is.
I share Josh's concerns. Mm-hmm. Part of me thinks that if we could deal with some of the angst that happens at the middle school,
sounds like there's two pieces to this. The first one is to move through the process to a stronghold on Noble Flex, and then it does sound like there's some interest and inquiry about the 4 positions at the middle school. So let's take the Noble Flex first and go through that, and then we'll revisit the conversation about the 4 teachers at the middle school. So the way it's worded is to remove Noble Flex. The vote last time was 2 in favor, 7 not. So right now for the stronghold, it's the removal of Noble Flex.
This is global, so we can redo it.
Yeah, okay. So we'll hold that. Denise, could you hold up the four teachers, what that was?
What you discussed.
Okay.
Yeah, the budget was, it was 19, tab 19.
I think that number is the four teacher and the three attacks, not just the four teachers.
Laura, can you just say that louder? I don't hear you.
I said, my notes, who knows if they're correct or not, show that that included the four teachers and the three attacks in that number, which I don't know if that was correct.
And I think to that point, if it's a 233 for the four teachers and the three ed techs, I'd be in favor of all seven. Because that's how loud I hear the speakers.
Do you want to, Principal Archibald, you want to just come forward?
Just now that we're talking about this. Talk about being put on the spot, huh? Can you speak into the mics? I can't hear you.
I'm sorry. So what are your thoughts about this constant narrative and concern about bullying in middle school? And I this is not exactly a one-to-one, I mean, removing these teachers, I know, isn't a direct impact, but I do feel like it's something that, as a board, we need to address because of the volume of the concerns.
Sure. Really hard. I've talked to a lot of people this year about this, and we've made some, I would say, standardized some significant consequences for this type of behavior. Both sides of this behavior, it's really a horrifying conversation when you're talking to a family of a victim and an offender. They're both our kids. They're both kids who need an opportunity to grow. They both have positive futures. So like it's really, it's a walk. And I can tell you that when I talk to victims and their families, oftentimes it does not seem like it's enough. When I talk to people who have offended, people are really upset about the significance of the consequence. And so I've been spending a lot of time working with people trying to help understand that if we want to address the bullying situation in our schools, we can't pick and choose what we're going to address and when it's comfortable to address. And so I think that we've been really steady and consistent this year, which is really hard because I have not talked to one single parent who sends their kid to school to bully kids. And so when I make that call, to an 11-year, about an 11-year-old or a 13-year-old. This is not something that parents are like happy to hear about. They're frustrated. They don't understand why this is happening. And so it's hard, and it feels like, you know, that we're pushing a point all the time. I guess what I don't have a whole lot of answers for this. We've had some staffing challenges throughout the year, so we have not had a ton of consistency in various areas, and so there's that. There's a lot of excitement about the summer work and the planning and some things that we're going to put in place, and I already have a plan to come to the school board regularly and to show you data from this year with referrals, with suspensions, and I really have confidence with the team that this, you're going to see a difference. I really believe that. I wouldn't be here, I wouldn't say it if I did not have the confidence that it would be, that it's going to shift. So this is not solving any of the problem, the question about next year. I would just like anybody, I would tell you that we would take any additional staff member. Like we need more people, everybody needs more people. We can run Noble Middle School with the proposed cuts. We can do it. I would tell you if we could not. I would tell you that this is, there's going to be some challenges, and we're going to have to make some shifts with how we program. But we can do it.
And I appreciate that. I just think, from my perspective, I, as a board member, I do think that I feel like I need to make sure that we're making a statement about what we're doing about this, because the level, the volume of it really seems significant. I'm a parent of two kids who were bullied in school. Mental health is significantly impacted by that. And I think as a country, we talk about, I'm not a gun person. I hate them. I don't want them anywhere. But we also, as a country, love to talk about, oh, it's mental health. It's mental health. I worry that if we're putting more kids in the classroom, teachers are going to have less ability to impact or deal with those situations. And I do hope there's consistency. I think what I hear, what I experience, is seeing kids over and over and over doing it. And I know a lot of teachers who feel like there aren't enough resources to get an offender out of the room for enough time for it to be practical, and the student's back in the room and they're dealing with the same issue again. So I think that's my issue with taking teachers out. It's just, we have a school that's having those issues. What are the resources, and are we cutting those resources short at a time when that school really could use the extra support? But,
and I'll stand here and tell you that I would take any additions. I'm not saying no. And I want to be clear about that. But I understand the situation. We're talking about numbers, and I've heard numbers that are not going to add up when we talk about this. And so,
Mr. Archibald, maybe this is an opportunity to be creative in that you keep the teams that you have planned, but you get creative with additional staff members, so you come to, you know, superintendent and say, if I did this, we could deal with those hot issues and keep them in school, and we can make changes. I think, you know, from my point of view, I'm trying to empower you in a way, say, okay, so what's your dream? In 1 year, if you were to totally flip the script to Noble Middle School, what do you need to flip the script? In 1 year, because every parent, I can't say every parent, that's not fair. But many parents come to me and they are scared, they're nervous for their kids and all this, so we don't have years. We have months, we have weeks, right? So what do we need to do to flip the script? And that's the pressure, that's the hard part. And so, you know, I just can't imagine cutting, you know, 7 staff members when that's the place we need to flip the script the most. And that is a tough age group, man. I remember being 11, 13 years old. Like, thank God I had the teachers that I did, and administrators that I did that helped me accountable, the parents I did, right? They got me through that tough time, and I know that we do, but what's the dream, right? What do you need to flip the script? And if it is these extra staff members, then okay.
let's do it. I'll take the chin, I'll take it on the chin, I will speak to all the community members who speak to me, and I will justify it, and I'll say, well, we're gonna flip the script of our middle school. And I think that's powerful. It's a powerful opportunity.
Like I told you, I would take up any staff member that you're, any position, and I, you know, these are conversations that I have every day with my team, and about planning and about making big ticket sort of big sweeping changes, right? And not big sweeping changes sounds scary. Like just flipping the script, just like what you're saying, to install things that support students, and it is a challenging age, but I'll tell you, it's a really fun age too. There's a lot of fun that happens, and there is a lot of smiles in the middle school. So I'm sure I talk to a lot of folks too, and I appreciate that people give me a shot and call me, and we agree to disagree on some things. But I will tell any family out there to call me, and we'll talk and we'll try to work it out.
So are we tracking incidents? Remember when we went and we moved eighth grade up to the high school? We were at that time having a lot of issues with 7-8. We moved 8 up and it was 6-7. We saw a huge decrease in the number of incidents. Is that changing? I mean, so you know what I'm talking about, this volume of...
Yeah. So, like I said, there's a lot of situations that obviously I can't get into right here, right now. And so, yeah, there's some significant increases with mental health. You talked about it. Huge increases in some significant indicators like DHS reports, crisis referrals, huge, like.
Just as you guys know, we've been working with the community, talking about all of these issues. I just actually got off with Tim Town this afternoon. Chief Town is looking. Berwick in particular has had some significant increases in just behavioral stuff at that middle school level, downtown in Berwick. North Berwick had it in like a year and a half past, 2 years ago, but that's still, it is just increased. Unfortunately, if it were just Noble Middle School in terms of like, but it's society, like we have a lot of societal issues, particularly in that 11, 12, 13 year old. And Tim just actually invited us to go to a conference with him about policing teens, because they're struggling so much in that age range. There's a conference in Brooklyn that I think Audrey and I are going to head to with him. So this is not specific to us, but you know, to your point, we're dealing with that, right? And if we could flip the switch, that would be awesome. But I do think that we are looking at some large societal pieces that we are needing to address in our schools, and that's what's happening. So we keep doing the work, right? That's what we keep doing.
I'm anxious to hear about your model, what you're planning, it strikes me that if we had a way to make sure some of those repeat offenders can be kept out of classrooms where other children are being impacted, it would make me feel better.
Yeah, so just to speak to that, Sue and I have met with families. We're probably approaching double digits at this point. So what's happened is we're employing a model where we have conversations, meeting with families, meeting with teachers, we install plans, and then when the level rises, right, like we're talking about 11-year-olds, so really, I'm trying to keep them, no offense, away from you. Like we're having honest conversations. Sue is doing a really nice job with families, with students. We're cycling back. We have plans for some of these repeat offenders, some of these high-level students. And we're working with their families directly. And you know, I think for the most part, we are seeing improvements, but you have to, improvements are relative, right? So there are things that are so far out of bounds that you can't compare a typical experience to. And so, When we are seeing improvements, sometimes that's coming to school every single day. And so I can, with a big smile, like I can think of situations right now where we have lots of work to do with little kids who are there, who are not doing exactly the right thing, but compared to where they were in September, wow, what a difference. And they should be so proud of the growth that they're making, and that the staff who are working with them need to be incredibly proud of the work that they're doing. So we are making a difference. It's really, and it's really tough, right? You could have some of the, when we talk about bullying and we talk about some of the really tough stuff that happens in middle schools forever, oftentimes it's not repeat offenders. Oftentimes it's friend groups that are breaking up. Kids are figuring out where they belong and also where they don't belong. And so that happens. Kids are really trying to shake it up. And so they say mean things, they attack a person in a way that is horrifying to adults. And we're always trying to navigate that. And so it would be really easy if it was just one big bad bully and we just could say sorry. But every single kid that I have addressed in this situation is about this big and cute. And some of them are big like this, but they're all little kids still, 11 to 13. They're not, there are no big bad bulls in middle school. There really are not, there's not one. They're all just somebody's kid who's doing the best that they can and we're working really hard.
Yeah, I totally understand that. And so it's not about vilifying anyone. It's about how you protect everyone, all of them, and not push out any group of students. But I mean, I don't think it does anybody any good if I think we end up with no class. If we can protect kids and help kids treat each other better younger, we don't have that translating into high school students who don't want to be at school because of what they, I mean, I've lived through that with my daughter. That was a real struggle to get her to come back to school with that. So I don't know, the numbers are increasing.
So I guess my question would be, are you looking at these positions solely as numbers? Like these seven positions, are you looking at them specifically as classroom teachers? Are you looking at, or classroom teachers by text? Are you looking at allowing Mike to make some decisions about support services with this funding? So there's a lot to unpack with that.
So the figure would be 297,275. That is for just the four teachers. So that's about a $38,000 difference between flex, because I know that was a question as well.
Yeah, I guess my thought is the latter. I could not. I just would like to speak for those that, and whatever you need to address the problem effectively. And if it's not keeping these teachers, I don't know what it is, but I look forward to hearing about it.
Yeah, I defer to administration. I mean, yeah, I mean, Mike, it's your building. It's your call. But I think this is an opportunity to empower you. And obviously, with Sue and Audra, you know, looking at it, say, you know, when you say, you know, kid has whatever, 20 referrals or whatever, my heart goes, holy. If my daughter was in that class, I'd be losing my ever-loving mind, right? Because that's happened. I mean, I know teachers address 10 negative behaviors for every one they refer. So that's 200 disruptions in the classroom. We haven't even had anywhere near 200 days of school, right? So, like, I think you and I are saying the same thing. We are concerned about just the sheer number of disruptions for all the other students, and it takes away their opportunity to learn. It takes away a teacher's opportunity to teach, and we need to figure out, I agree, I want those kids to grow too. I want them to grow and not detract away from the students who are making the right choices every single day. I want them to figure out how to earn the privilege to be in that class so that they're not taken away from the learning of others. I don't have a specific plan to make that happen, but I'm trying to, I mean, my goal tonight would be to empower you to figure out how do we do that, what do you need to do that, and I do believe that would flip the script.
So, I'll take
take what? was that the four teachers and three ed techs, or was that just the four teachers? That's just the four teachers, just four teachers.
So, I'm just going to define this straw poll just to see where we're at, okay? So, I'm going to define the straw poll that might reevaluate with Sue and Audra the staff that he's considering reducing as per this conversation. Figure out how to flip the script. What staff do you need to truly address that? And I'm asking you to go back to the drawing board and figure out what that would look like. If it means not bringing back all four, if it's bringing back three, like, That's my question, right? My question is reevaluate, tell us what you need to put the script in a year. I mean, I know that's crazy to put a timeline on it, but all goals have timelines.
Sure.
It'd be no more than 296, is that what I heard?
So sorry, so
297.
So you're saying
up to, right?
Yeah. Yes.
So that's what I'm defining as a strong. That is your round.
I just want to be
yep.
Black and white.
Here. I'm glad you're asking.
Okay.
So is it possible instead of teachers, would it behoove you to have NTECs in the classroom so they were more hands, more ears listening to what's going on? As opposed to adding teachers who are in classrooms alone.
Like parsing it out in front of the board this time, I don't think it's fair to Mike. I don't think it's fair to our administration. I think just saying, hey, go back and let us know what you think you need. I mean, staffing is staffing. Whether it's teachers at text, staffing is staffing. I apologize, but I don't think it's appropriate.
It sounds to me like we're asking for all possibilities to look at.
So the timeline on that, then, we need to finalize next week, right?
Yes. So there's not a lot of time here.
Just to remind you, the other part of the initial conversation was that the middle schools did have lower scores, and we were looking at the testing and everything, and that concern of reducing teachers and lower test results and that side of it, too.
Reinstating a dollar figure at least.
We don't have a dollar figure though, do we?
Essentially, next week, we're not going to get a detailed plan of the week, right? We're going to get just a rough outline. This is what staff we need, and then, so I don't know that we're going to know a whole lot more next week than we do now. I mean, we'll know a number, right? I mean, That's what we'll know. But as far as the trajectory of the middle school and trajectory of flex, we won't know any more next Thursday than we know now. Is that safe to say, or is that an inappropriate assumption?
I think that's safe to say. However, one thing that was mentioned before was, could we say, going back to the middle school, could you just say up to 290,000 or 297,000, so we know that that's the stop, the highest point. That at least gives us a framework.
Yeah, I'd actually say 259.
Yes,
for flexes.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Just
yep.
What we're investing in flex, invested up to that amount in the middle school to address the issues.
So in other words, you pull flex and invest that money back in middle school.
I will preface a little bit that when the schedules were created, those schedules were draft only, just so you could see that it could be done. Both Principal Keniston and Principal Jolly said that they would work collaboratively with their teams so that it was a very doable schedule. But that was just for purposes to show that it could occur.
I'll just kind of review some things I said. There's a staffing inequity right now in our elementary schools. That's as I understood it. So if APSA is wrong, please clarify me. There's a staffing inequity that we have expressive arts or specialist teachers at North Berwick who have more than a dozen hours per week available to intervene with students, and they are intervening. I think they're being used well. I don't discount that. They're working with kids, but that luxury does not exist at our other elementary schools. And so I don't know how long this has been going on. Like how long have these extra hours existed when enrollments went down and there was an adjustment, but we didn't adjust expressive arts. But it sounds like it's been going on for at least a few years. But not consolidating is a vote to maintain inequity. I mean, if we're not going going to vote to consolidate, then I almost feel pressed to add staff at Huzzy and Lebanon to provide them with the same opportunities to intervene with our kids who need it. I just, it's gotta be one or the other, in my opinion. We either have to add staff at maybe Huzzy and Lebanon to intervene like that's happening in North Berwick, or consolidate staff. That's just how I see it.
I have a couple of problems with it. I couldn't tell from those schedules that we go, where is the ending course going? It's unrealistic for the day, so I think that's a scheduling issue, because your music teacher's gonna, I mean, I know music wasn't the focus, but still, that's not in there. You gotta pull these kids up, their classes at the end of the day to come back to band course. Like they're gonna miss, you know, STEAM or whatever special day their class has. The other thing that has are the regular classroom teachers ready to take up a whole bunch of duties? Because these people have been doing a lot of duties. So
okay, the student you want me to speak to the band. And then Principal John might like to respond.
I can speak to band and chorus. In the schedules that you got the second round, didn't get a music schedule because it became quite clear that I talked to the first time that music is just, there's a lot more to it. There are a lot less unscheduled hours because of all the lessons, and especially at Milton where we have just an enormous chorus and band, we need that. So chorus currently at Milton happens 2 days a week. The very end of the day from 2:15 to 3. Our course is so large, we do it 2 days. It's over 110 kids. And then band is the same time on two other days. And again, it's so large that we do it twice. That would still be currently in the draft schedule how I would propose it, but I have a scheduling team, so we can go through that and make sure that that happens. And so when you do have chorus and band at Milton, you'll walk through the halls and you'll see some classes that are pretty empty, to be honest with you, which is fantastic because it's that many kids that are participating in music. So in that sense, we're not cutting the music, so be the same thing going there.
And as for duties,
I wouldn't have the duty schedule prepared until we were closer to the start of the school year. It depends upon staffing, enrollment numbers. For example, last year we hired a kindergarten teacher 4 days before school started. So that's an extra body for duty coverage. Right now we're not using any of our part-time staff members, such as our, we just started using our math coach. 1 day a week to fulfill a duty. That's a missed opportunity we could utilize for next year in a greater capacity. Mrs. Anderson and I, the assistant principal, and I could pick up duties more. We go out in a kind of more casual basis when there's a higher needs grade level or we're noticing an incident at, say, third grade recess, which is my bicycle crew, will be out there more frequently, but we could have more assigned duties to it. We certainly don't want to add any more work onto the classroom teacher schedule. That is not the goal of it. But I do believe that I could create an equitable duty schedule with the draft that we proposed to you. I already kind of put together something where it didn't put too much more onto anybody's plates. The other layer to it is that in the morning, the duties that are assigned to the specialists aren't duties that are necessary. Administration is very present in the morning and at dismissal, so I wouldn't need to assign anybody to those duties because there's already people. So the duties that I would assign to the specialists are during lunch and recess blocks. And in the schedule that I shared with you as a draft, there are not classes scheduled during that time. So they are still available. And I just want to address this because I will not be able to sleep if I don't. You're right. We are grateful and we're lucky at North Berwick to have this flexibility. But I do want to just say, we're not overstaffed at North Berwick. We are slim. We don't have anybody that does our second staff curriculum. That's my counselor. She does all 504s. She sees over 100 kids a week, and she does second staff. I don't have any interventionists that pulls groups. That's myself and my entire support team, which is teachers. We really don't have an abundance of team, and that's my staff that does has all of that support. Like, they are truly phenomenal. So, I would overanalyze not speaking up, and I just wanted to say that. But yes, we are lucky to have best flexibility of schedule, and I maximize that. But it's my team that came to me and said, hey, we're open, use us. So I did. But we don't have an abundance of people. We're not swimming with additional staff. There's not a lot of facts to cut it up. We're pretty slim. And my team helped make it work.
So just speaking of an abundance of staff, just to run the numbers for you for each of the elementary schools, so when you look at staff per student ratio at the elementary schools, North Berwick has one staff member per seven students, Hussey School has one staff member per eight students, Hanson and Lebanon Elementary have one staff member per seven students, Knowlton School has one staff member for 6.5 students, so one staff member from 6.5 students. That is current, that is this year. And so when you look at it in those terms, as Principal Jolly said, there's not an overabundance of staff. It's right in line right now, staffing-wise. We don't have a tip in either direction. So
that's with or without removing?
That is currently right now.
And what does North Berwick go to when we remove those?
Probably three or four students higher. So they would be closer to Hussey.
Well, three or four? Or close to Hussey's one to eight, is it right?
So eight, so it would go to four tens, so would be closer to the Hussey number.
What's Hussey?
Eight.
Right. So it's gonna be more than Hussey. So right now, in terms of equity, we're there.
In terms of equity of student to staff ratio,
right.
In terms of staff who have time, right, it's unfilled, filled, but unfilled with special skill.
Right. If we don't vote in favor of this for equity, is there something, because I know this is always a thing with special resources, teachers in the same contract. Something that can be put in place to like show it's equitable or I know Stella just said different things that she's utilizing her team for and they want her to utilize it, like put something in writing so like it is equity and we're kind of covered
Well, to the point of we can certainly look across the district and see to Josh's point about what's happening at Hussey because it's not equitable. As far as that piece, we can certainly look at bringing some support over to Hussey and to Lebanon to help make that more equitable. So not consolidating specialists, but just utilizing the staff that we have differently so that everybody is doing what we have hired them to do, yes.
I'm just trying to wrap my head around those the ratios
yes.
that you gave.
Mm-hmm.
So the consolidation would be shared staff, right? So in that scenario, it wouldn't be just North Berwick, like just losing whatever three or four. I don't know what it is, right? So let's just say four. Just four, right? So it actually would be a reduction of two because it's shared. Does that make sense? Like it's half, right?
Two what?
So if the reduction of consolidating is consolidating, so I'm assuming there's four grade teachers at Knowlton and four teachers at North York that essentially do the same instruction, right? So if we were consolidating, then we'd be reducing by four staff. That's what consolidating
means. We're reducing by three staff.
Thank you.
So we're talking in the difference between student ratio.
I appreciate it. So now, thank you for clarifying. Three staff, right? So when we consolidate, since we're not reducing North Berwick by three staff members,
correct.
We're reducing them by one and a half.
Correct.
And if
correct.
We divide that out, you're saying that that would increase three kids per staff member just by reducing one?
Potentially, yes.
But
mathematically, that just doesn't make sense. That doesn't square in my head.
It's more like 7.25 or something. Like, you're right. Like, it's two
staff. It's a fraction, right?
And assuming, 275 kids. It would be 7.25 students per student.
little more in line.
So essentially, I mean, essentially it doesn't significantly, not in any significant way change ratios.
These are the items that we handed out and gave quick overviews for last week. So we will start with the discontinue the assistant athletic director. If you look back to those sheets that we provided last week, we do have the highlights, and it also talks about the monetary, what that would be. Before I begin this section, do we want to take the items that we have already gone through and just get a sense from Denise?
Yes.
Okay.
I think that the five items there, we have the strong will say to remove them. So that 655309 number is a decrease. That being said, so that brings us to our 6.33. The prospect of adding in the 215 up to 259 or 297, I don't know which, would bring the bottom line increase to 7.77 if you brought back in 259,000 from middle school teachers or supports.
Okay.
I will tell you right now that based on our I'm comfortable with that number. I will publicly say I'm comfortable. 7.77. I personally, that's where I am. I can justify that. Should you guys want to continue? We can do that. What's the board want to do?
Appreciate your open.
obviously continue from there. So we're not done.
Do we need to take a stop while we were at?
To not look back, we will stick with what we've done for right now. So we're just looking
start bullets. Okay. Ready to do that? 1, 2, 3.
Just a straw poll of where we're at. Are we comfortable with 7.77, right? That whether the middle school comes back, can't come back any greater than that number. So we know that 7.77 as a max could be slightly less, depending on what they come back with the middle school. So it would be a straw poll for a 7.77 max.
Can you state that out loud for the?
That was 7-1 for to look at 7.7%. So, next week we will be meeting to go through all budget documents and get some additional information from the middle school about those positions and what the intent will be for them.
That's great. I think part of my other research is just looking at numbers and looking at ahead to next year. Just as an FYI, I think this is good to speak publicly on this and also think about it as a board. Essentially, the ESSER funds will be used up. That's like $2.4 million that we use up next year. And we are taking from our reserve funds that have $1.6 million. That will be available next year. So right off the bat, next year, without any cost changes whatsoever, without any, it's an 8% increase, approximately. So, just keep that in mind. And we know staff contracts, like people, we're increasing salaries, right? And 85% of our budget is personnel and salaries and benefits, all's going up. So the baseline is 8%. It's just plus from there. So just kind of, these hard conversations aren't going to stop.
That can shift. Talking about energy costs that can change sending money back.
But that's not going to be $4 million.
It can though. I mean, it's not
that. It's not going to be $4 million.
I'm not suggesting that there's going to be a windfall anywhere, but I don't know. So
I have a question. Tab 22, where it has the 3 different percent increases. One is specifically just the budget versus the final number is the output to taxpayers. This 7.77 is the final output to taxpayers. Is that correct? Perfect.
I just want to clarify, you're looking at the revenue sheet, is that what you're looking at? And so at the top you have an increase in expenses, $49,808,000.
Yes.
And then you go down through. Yes, so down to the bottom where it was 14.07, I have 7.77. With taking into account the changes we did today and bringing back up to $259,000 for the middle school. So it could go below that if we need less.
So what is the actual, like last year, I know everything went up, but we still got the budget by 0.4%. So what is the actual school budget increase, that top line you have? If you don't have that right now, that's fine. I just have to be, I think that's good information to
have. I'm still not clear. What do you mean
the
increase?
The expenses and then to the taxpayers.
Yes. So to the top number, the expenditures are going up 7.13% with tonight's changes. The projected increase or decrease in local taxes, that line toward the bottom third of the page, would be 7.8. And then the bottom number after all three categories is 7.77. Is that what you wanted?
Yeah.
Thank you. All right, Jill.
just a really quick piece for the board. We do have an executive session Tuesday night scheduled. We do have a quorum. There are some legal things and some special education things going on, so just check your email because we may need to change that again. And we acknowledge how hard that is, that it's happened last Tuesday, it could potentially happen again. But again, some of it is legal and we just, that timing is just out of our hands. So 6:30 on Tuesday night for the executive session.
But it might get moved.
So I check your email.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Keep an eye on your email.
Yes. Thank you. And that will be in the conference room at the Central.